got out the calendar for 2017. And it was pretty much blank except for what the company had put in for the holidays. And last night, I looked at our calendar for 2016. Boy, a lot of writing in there. Need to do this, need to go there, appointment here, need to get this paid, get this done, and it just all filled up. Well, you know, we sort of start with a new calendar, and our calendars are going to be pretty empty right now. And we really don't know what 2017 will hold. Certainly our thoughts and our hopes is that it's going to be a wonderful, wonderful year, and I trust that it will. With Jesus Christ, even when I went back and looked at 2016, and we had a couple appointments last year that we were waiting on test results. And as I look back at those, one of the toughest times, even for a Christian, I believe, is that time where you go to the doctor, but you're waiting on results. And as I went back and looked through it, I saw God's handprints in it all the way. You know, you all talk about God being with us all the time and how true that is, and footprints in the sand, how that is so true that when we look back, we see God's handprints, God's footprints in all that we do. This week also, in businesses, you make strategic plans. And so get together meetings and lay out the strategic plans. In fact, next Sunday, in some ways, is going to be a strategic plan for this church. Next Sunday, I'm going to bring a message of what would Paul say to Safe Harbor Community Church. And I think it's going to be a good message, and I look forward to that. But as I spoke with someone about the strategic plan I had for myself and for work, I realized that I really couldn't separate my spiritual life and my work life. They blend together so much. Isn't that true? I mean, you walk for God. None of us are perfect. Man, I still make plenty of mistakes. I praise God for God's grace and God's mercy. But the three things I wrote down were basics, simplicity, and relationships. Now, of course, when I'm at my work, they said, oh, I see how that fits in. The basics of work, doing your job, the simplicity of doing things in a simple way, yet a way that is productive. And relationships, yes, you build relationships, and that's how you build a productive team. And I thought, well, yes, but I was thinking about me. So maybe you don't know it, but probably you have a strategic plan for 2017. Let me list to you as far as resolutions. Now, there's a bunch of lists out there, but the top 10 that I found under this one list. Spend more time with family and friends was number one. Exercise. What? Lose weight. I guess those score to go together, but exercise was two, lose weight was three. I'm trying to cut back, and a lady at work gave me this 30-day plan. This thing's pretty ridiculous. You can't have any salt, any sugar, low carbs. You can't have any bread. You can't, just everything. So I'm doing some of it, but not all of it. And to beat it all, I don't supposed to have any spam. Can you believe that? Now, that ain't right. But anyway, I'm trying to come back, and now in the last 3 or 4 days, Liz and I have been, well, where can you go eat? Or have you ever gone to a grocery store and looked at something and see if it has any sodium in it? Everything has sodium in it. My goodness. So anyway, we're struggling along with that, but we'll see what happens. Number four, quit smoking. Number five, enjoy life more. That's where I got the simplicity of it. Leon gets so busy in life that you just don't enjoy those things. Quit drinking. Get out of debt. I guess both of those could sort of work together, couldn't they? Learn something new. I'm too old for that. But anyway, help others. Get organized. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, as we think about the world giving resolutions, and Father, we think about those, but Father God, I think the basic simplicity is really what it's about. You want us to have simple lives. And Father, there is nothing profound about this message, and I've just looked at three simple things that I think would make our life more enjoyable and would make 2017 a good year. So, Father, we just pray. I pray that you bless it. I pray that I may decrease, that you may increase. In Jesus' name, amen. Number one, in Ephesians 5, verses 15 through 17, it says this: be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Number one, pretty simplistic, as I said, these points. Be careful. Be careful. In my job, accidents is a big thing that we're always looking at, safety. And it says a lot of accidents happen when this happens. People get in a hurry, they begin to worry, they're trying to multitask and stress, and all that leads to more accidents. I thought, you know what? That leads to accidents in the Christian realm. In our walk with Christ, as we get in a hurry, how's your life? Is it in a hurry? Do you just go, go, go? I sometimes think, I feel like I'm going downhill, and if I stop, I'm going to fall flat on my face. It's just going, 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 almost a merry-go-round. Hurry can do that. We need to be careful. In order to be careful, we need to slow down a little bit. We need to count our blessings. And I'll pick that up in just a minute. Number two is worry. How are you doing on that? You know, I must admit, one of the challenges always through my life has been worry. And only through Christ have I been able to overcome that in many ways. But when something happens, my first thought is worry. Praise God. My second thought is get to God. I was so bad at one time in my life that I looked for something to worry about, but I didn't have anything to worry about. There has to be something there, right? I mean, you got this, everything's going too smooth. And if you're not careful, if we're not where we need to be with the Lord, it can be to where we feel that life is a balance act, that there's the same amount of good things and the same amount of bad things. And if you're not careful, you can even get to being paranoid that if so many good things are happening, oh man, I better be ready. And then Satan has us living in a paralyzed state of worry. And one of the great joys we had over the holiday season was having both of our sons and their wives in. And just being with family. I think I told you guys about that. My mom used to say, well, I just want the family around. I thought that was a bunch of garbage. What do you want? But as I get older, I understand that. But one of the biggest things that bothers me as a father is when my little boys, even though they're not little anymore, they're always little, aren't they? When they worry. And I think, man, I would do anything in the world to take that worry away. I don't really have the power of that. I have the power of prayer, and yes, that makes a lot of difference, but I don't have that strength. But my friends, the Almighty God has that strength. And if you, as one of His children, are in a state of worry, and even in a state of worry, it just continues to be that, you're just waiting for one bad thing after another, that has to grieve Him. Because He came to this world that you will not worry. My goodness, sometimes we can't enjoy things. And sometimes if we're not careful, we say, you know, I better not get too happy with this. Well, something bad is a-coming. So I'm going to try to keep it in me. Listen, folks. God came. He said Jesus came that you may have life and have it more abundant. Let's downright have fun. There were people last night that hugged their toilet sometime this morning. That believed that they had the time of their life last night. And sometimes other people have to tell them what they did. Folks, let me tell you. There's not a drink out there that'll make you have the time of life as much as it is as following Jesus Christ. Amen? Oh my goodness. I was talking to several people here, talking to Rita, and we were talking about, man, you can just, Rita, you know I love you, so let me say it like this. Okay.
Rita, oh, I hate it when he starts that way.
Rita, sometimes you think she's drinking on Sunday morning, ain't you? Because she just has that way about her. And one way I can tell when she's really not feeling well, she's not bubbly. Yeah. You know? But we're talking to each other, and sometimes we can be at places and people say, man, what are you drinking? And I think, I haven't been drinking at all. I'm just high on life. I'm high on Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And I can flat out have a good time. Now, I'm not here to thug people that I... Thug people? Hit people, whatever. I'm not saying a beer every once in a while, drink every once in a while is going to send you straight to hell. But I think you know where I'm coming from. Multitasking. Do you multitask? You know, I'm forced to do it, but I'm not very good at it. Any of you mean? My wife can better multitask when there's music going on. And it drives me up the wall. I cannot multitask with... But we can be doing all kinds of things, and she wants to put the music on. I said, no, I don't need something else going in my mind. And I read somewhere last week that that's sort of a man thing. Women do better with music than multitasking, and men don't do as well. I'm not good at multitasking. I'm forced to do it, but I'm really not that good at it. But again, being careful, even in that, folks, we can get so much into multitasking. And I know with jobs, there's so much responsibility, but we miss out on things. And sometimes, if we're not careful, we're more concerned with our job performance than our Christ performance. And folks, I have to look in the mirror at that. Because I hate to not have my job done. It drives me crazy. But sometimes, if I'm not careful, I got to be careful. If I'm not careful, I'm not as concerned. And this hurts to say. I can put the Lord to the side for a little while. Be careful in 2017. Stress. How's stress going for everybody? Not a worry in the world, right? No, I'm just kidding. Folks, listen. It's naive of us to think that in 2017 we will not have some stress. You can't live in this world without stress. So if you're beginning to think 2017, oh, I just hope that everything's going to be a free stress year. Well, you better find you a cave somewhere and get out of life, because it's not going to be that. It is true. How do we handle that stress? Not in the midst of it, but prior to that. Be careful. Build that relationship up with the Lord. One great thing about 2017 is, of course, the Lord offers this to us all the time. We'll just erase the board. Let's just start over. God gives us that opportunity all the time. And we're able to say, Lord, I'm just going to walk with you. I'm just going to be careful in all that I do and walk with you in your will. Colossians 3, 1 through 4 says this. Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things, for you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with Him in glory. Listen to this, folks. If this is not a thing to say, put it up there. This is where I'm going into 2017, just like this. Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your heart on things. That's so easy to read, isn't it? It's a little harder to put into action. Because our life is so consumed with so many things around us, it's hard to always keep your thoughts on things above. I know for 2017, for me, the retail world looks rough. I'm not sure how the job is going to make it or not going to make it through 2017. But again, my thoughts need to be, I need to be careful of what I'm thinking about. Who is in control? It's not the place I work for. It's God Almighty that's in control. And God, if you say no to this, you got a yes wait for me. So let me see what happens. Let me read that one more time. Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ, listen now, Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Quoting from the Scripture, He is praying for us. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. Boy, wouldn't that be great as we begin each day with that thought? I'm setting my thoughts on things above. It will change your world. Okay, number one, be careful. Number two, be thankful. I don't know what I have here. Let's find out together. It has to be thoughtful, but I don't know what I wrote down here. Okay, that's great. Y'all talk so much yourself, I'll figure it out. Verse 18, do not be drunk on wine, we sort of talked about that, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. There was a pastor that I read about that was preaching a message, and it ended up being a one-word message. But he said the title of his message is this: Lord, what's in religion for me? His sermon? Nothing. See, one thing that can happen to us if we're not careful in our walk with the Lord, we get a worldly. What can I get out of it? And if it don't motivate me, and if it doesn't do this, it doesn't do that, then I'm just going to try something else. And they asked this minister, how long did it take you to prepare this message? He said, 20 years. Lord, what can I do for you? That may be a different way of looking at things. I mean, I know we get so many blessings from God. I understand that. I mean, my goodness, heaven, and you know, there's just on and on and on. So it's not that we don't get a lot out of it. But to have the thoughtfulness, the insight to say, Lord, I want to work for you this year in all that I do. Some passages to support this. Colossians chapter 10, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Isn't that great words? Everything I do, Lord, I'm going to do for your glory. Now some people are going to think there's something wrong with you. That's okay. Everything I do, Lord, I'm going to do for your glory. That'll solve a lot of issues. That'll solve a lot of decision makings. If it don't glorify God, it's a no. That's how it is. Colossians chapter 5, verse 13 says this. You, my brothers, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge in sinful nature. Rather, serve one another in love. We know that we are set free from sin. If you're a child of God, and I believe everybody in here is a child of God today, that's between God and you, and I don't have anything to do with it. We are free. And what sort of drives the world crazy in a way, so you're saying I can go out and do whatever I want to? Well, yes, but no. Yeah, it's forgiven, but no, I can't do it. And it's not because God is there to say, don't do it. It's because I don't want to do it. It's completely changed from what the world sees freedom as being able to do everything I want, no matter what. Reminds me of a kid when he was getting ready to turn 18. You know, I saw a young girl getting her driver's license. I think she's on TV, and I know she probably didn't mean about it like this, but she said, I'm glad I don't have to ask my parents for the car anymore. I can just get in it and go. Freedom. But we understand the freedom that we have came with a cost for Jesus Christ. But as it says here, you, my brothers, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the sinful nature. I guarantee for any believer that they are indulging in sin, even though their sin are forgiven, they're living a miserable life. And if they did in 2016, their life is miserable. It will flat, listen, for a believer, it will eat you alive. Chapter 6, verse 2. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. Carry each other's burdens. Folks, I think that our church does a wonderful job at this, of trying to carry each other's burdens. I'm sure we can do more. I'm sure we can do better. I know this pastor. What a joy it is to be able to have people that you can come to and you can pray with that will not judge you. Verses 9 and 10 says this. Let us not become weary in doing good, for the proper time will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, we have opportunity to let us do good to all people, especially those who belong to the family of believers. Let us not become weary in doing good. For at the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Our church is at a crossroads. We'll go talk about more of that next week and in the message. But we can't become weary of doing good. It's too important. We've got to stay the course, I guess, for lack of better words. We've got to remain committed to God, because I believe God still wants to do great things in our lives and in those lives of people around us. This reminds me of, let me read the next one. Matthew chapter 22. Teacher, what is the great commandment in the law? Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second like it, love your neighbor as yourself. All the law of the prophets hang on these two commandments. 2017, if you're not already there, I hope you'll be there. If you need to recommit, I hope you do that. But love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. Isn't that a great way to begin 2017? So we have be careful, be thoughtful. And number three, be thankful. But once again, in Ephesians chapter 5, not so sure, but I think they turned the heat up almost down there. But we don't want them to get too cold. Speak to not one another with psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord. Always giving thanks to God, the Father of everything, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Being thankful. As you look back over 2016, as you self-examine, would you think that if people analyze you, would they say, that's a very thankful person? That's a person. Ain't nothing. You know, it's a challenge. Liz has a tendency to bring it to see good in things. And I say I'm a realist. She's an optimist. But being a realist sometimes can move on pessimists if you're not careful. But the fact is this. And we got to do that. I don't know. I guess maybe it's from a work or something. You deal with the facts. You deal with the numbers. You don't, you know, and that's it. But if we don't learn to be thankful, folks, we will walk around our whole life miserable. And in some ways, it can be perceived that nothing's going to make them happy. And you may as well give up. It's just not going to happen. Now, those times when I get pessimistic, I'm really not a good witness to the Lord. Even though I'm not cussing, I'm not drinking, I'm not throwing things, I'm not showing my temper, I'm not doing all that. But if you spend time with me during my pessimism, you shouldn't say, well, man, this guy just... One of my philosophies used to be years ago that I still will pop back up and not push it back down was that if I prepare for the worst, I can handle everything else. Well, now that'll do you some real good. Talk about stress and worry. You end up worrying about far more stuff that never happens. But I'm ready. I'd rather say I'm ready with Jesus. If tough times come, and they may, and they will eventually, I will just hang on to Jesus. I want to say I walk through it with Jesus, but I'm more of a hanging on guy. Jesus carried me through. Carried me through. Be thankful. Would it change your life? Would it change lives of those around you? Or do you know of somebody that it would just flat out change so much about them if they began to be a thankful individual? Of starting out each day, one thing I'm thankful for, and that's the one I'm going to make sure that I bring that up. What about going to your job and saying, I'm thankful for this job? I go to my job and say, oh man, I got so much I got to do. I got 8 hours, I got 14 hours worth of stuff to do. And you're just going like this. How about a stop for a short prayer? Lord, I just thank you for this job. And I thank you for getting me out of it and find me a good one. No, I'm just. Well, but folks, it'll change your life when your beginning thoughts are thoughts of thankfulness. And listen, it's not only job related, it's people related. Sometimes with a can't make them happy attitude, you're going to alienate people away from you. Because it's hard to be around somebody like that. And listen, folks, I know we have some tough times in our lives. And sometimes we have pessimistic times, and sometimes we are down and hurting. But I understand this from reading the Bible, we need each other. We need believers. We need those around us. We need support groups. And I tell you what, if somebody tells me I don't need anybody, I think they're full of it. And sometimes they've chosen because they say, I don't think people want to be around me, so I'll be the first. I'll take the first step of saying I don't want to be around you. Be thankful. Let me just read a few verses here, and then we'll close. Talk about the election. Psalms. I believe I could find Psalms. Psalm 103, verses 1 through 3. Praise the Lord, O my soul, all my inmost being. Praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires and good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. What difference could we make in someone's life if we become a person of thankfulness? If you're trying to reach somebody, sometimes that's a good way. Psalm 77. I remembered you, O God, and I groaned, I mused, my spirit grew faint. You kept my eyes from closing. I was too troubled to speak, even in those times. And the psalm starts out with, I cried out to God for help. And later goes on to say that God helped me. Philippians 2:13, be thankful for God in those tough times as well. Philippians 2, verse 13, familiar passage. For it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. I want folks to see a person of thankfulness, and I want them to know the reason it is Jesus Christ. It's solely him. And I know I'm hitting on this a little heavy, but what would happen if every day, two times a day, you said to people what you were thankful for? Would they recommend a drug test? Or would they say, there's a difference? And would they not a week or 2 weeks down the road say, I know she started doing something. Why is that? Here we go. Let me tell you about Jesus. Now, I'm not telling you to preach at him. It's just telling you that, listen, Jesus has changed my life. I'll close with this resolution. A man called his mom and dad to wish him a happy New Year. His dad picked up the phone and he said, Dad, what's your resolution for the coming year? He said, to make your mother's life as happy as I can all year. Mom got on the phone and said, well, Mom, what is your resolution? To make sure your dad keeps his resolution. Yeah. 2017. The calendar's blank now. It will begin to fill up. Let's walk through it with Jesus Christ. And I trust this will be a wonderful year for you personally, your spiritual life, for those around you, and even for Safe Harbor. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your word. Father God, you're awesome. And Lord, we just pray that we'll begin each day looking on things above. And not let the things of the world cause so much harm and worry and stress. Cause us to do so much multitasking. And Father, we pray that also, Lord, we'll be thankful. And Father, sometimes we can be thankful inside, but when we utter those words of naming those things to be thankful for, it makes a difference in our lives and the lives of those around us. So Lord, help us as we walk with you into 2017 and throughout the year. God bless each and every one here, the families that they represent, for this coming year. In you, Father, we have a great faith. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.